Come on, everybody, put your hands together. Everybody. say, clap your hands, hold your teeth. Come on, make a shout of victory in here. I don't see you clapping your hands. Come on. Turner, come on.
Clap your hands.
Greetings, I'm Prophetess Charlene D. Holtz.
And I'm Bishop Randall E. Holtz. And we want to welcome you to the New Hope MBC Ministries of Miami, where we believe in building strong families for the 21st century and beyond.
We welcome you to our live broadcast as we prepare to hear the word of the Lord. We invite you to join us in the praise and worship experience. Please invite a friend or two to come along as well.
Now, let's go right into the service.
Are y'all ready to just praise God this morning? Are y'all ready to love on God this morning? It's time to have church. Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on and give God praise. Come on, those that love the Lord, come on and give him praise. Come on, those that are truly excited about God, come on and give him praise. Come on, those that got a reason to praise him, come on and give him praise. Come on, those that want to magnify him this morning, give him praise. Come on, those that want to lift him up, come on, give him praise. Those excited about God, give him praise. Come on, those that's enjoying God, come on, give him praise. Come on, he's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, put those hands together. Come on, we're going to worship him. We're going to celebrate him. We're excited about the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo. Come on. Clap those hands. Come on. Woo. Yes. Hallelujah. Come on. Give it to God. Come on. Lord, you're good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever.
Hey, Lord, you're good,
Lord,
yes.
Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever.
Hey, Lord, you're good, yes.
Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever.
Oh, Lord, you're good,
Lord,
yes.
Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever.
Come on, people from every nation.
People from every nation and tongue.
Well,
from generation.
Now come on. Let's worship.
We worship.
Lord, you're good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever.
Come on, worship the Lord. Lord, you're good.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you're good.
Lord,
yes.
You are good and your mercy is enduring forever.
Come on, people from every nation. Come on, that's everywhere. From now, shout out to God. We worship you. Come on. So good, yeah. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Come on, let's have fun. Come on. Because you are good all the time. All the time. You are good. You are good all the time. All the time. You are good. Come on.
You are good all the time.
Come on.
All the time.
Yes. Lord, you're good.
All the time.
Lord, you're good.
All the time.
Lord, you're good.
All the time.
Come on, he's an awesome God. Yeah. Come on, give him an awesome praise. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Come on, if that was for me, I'd be all right. But I say give him an awesome praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God, we just bless your name.
Yes.
God, it feels so good that you sing your praises yes. this morning. Hallelujah. God, we just let go and let go of, yes. let go of everything.
Yes.
And just let God have his way.
Yes.
You're just able to worship him freely. There's nothing like free worship. That's being free to just raise your hand. Being free to just lift your voice
yes.
and magnify the Lord. Come on, he's so worthy to be praised. Come on, everybody, he's worthy to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We bless your name. Hallelujah. Come on, come on, everybody. Come on, it's worship time. It's worship time. Hallelujah. God, we lift your voice. We magnify your name. We glorify your name. We lift you up, God. We lift you up. We magnify you. We magnify you. Come on. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, does your hallelujah belong to him this morning? Hallelujah. Your hallelujah belongs to God this morning. Come on, my hallelujah belongs to him. Hallelujah. Does your hallelujah belong to God? Come on, we worship in the day. Come on, come on, come on. You came here. You came to give God praise. You came to worship the Lord. Come on and give God praise. Hallelujah. Come on, he's been good to you. Come on, I see you. He's been good to you. Come on, he's still working things out.
Yeah.
He's still blessing. He's still sending God miracles. God is an awesome God.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Yes, he is.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Yes.
My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. You deserve it. You deserve it. Everybody all over the building, say that song with us. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on, that's your highest praise. Are you really saying that? My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Oh, my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on, everybody, lift your voice. You deserve it.
You deserve it.
People of God say, you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Oh God, you deserve it.
You deserve it.
You deserve it.
You deserve it.
Come on, let's say my hallelujah once again.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on, that's your highest praise. Come on, if you can't stand, just lift your hands up to God this morning. Come on, send your praise up. I dare you to send them up. He'll send them down. My hallelujah, my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Oh,
my hallelujah belongs to you.
Everybody say you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Come on, lift your voice and say,
you deserve it.
Lord God, you deserve all of our praise. All of our worship, God. You deserve it.
You deserve it.
Hey. I say hallelujah.
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 on, you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Come on, talk to the Lord. Let him know.
You deserve
He deserves all our praise, all our worship this morning. Come on, you deserve
you
it.
You deserve it.
You deserve it. You deserve
you
it.
Deserve it.
Let everybody on one accord. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah.
Yes.
Belongs to
Come on, give God praise. My hallelujah, my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on, let's say it one more time with one loud voice. Come on, big choir. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on, last time. My hallelujah, Lord.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Now come on and worship him. Come on, you're standing to your feet. You just said your hallelujah belongs to him. I dare you to give him a crazy praise in his place. Come on, I dare you to give him a radical praise in his place. Come on, I dare you to lift your voice and shout like God is hallelujah. The greatest.
Hallelujah.
He is the awesome.
Hallelujah.
He is the greatest God of
hallelujah.
All time. He is the real GOAT.
Hallelujah.
If y'all know what that means, the greatest of all time. He is the real GOAT. Come on, we give God praise. Come on, he's worthy to be praised.
Yeah.
He's worthy to be magnified. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah is the highest praise. Amen. That is the highest praise you can give the Lord. So we got to say hallelujah. We got to give God the highest praise, his just praise. We got to praise God through everything that's going through all of your situations. We got to give God praise.
That's
Amen.
Right.
So
right.
Let's just praise God this morning.
Hallelujah.
Let's lift him up this morning.
Hallelujah.
Let's thank God this morning.
Hallelujah.
He is a good God. He is
hallelujah.
Doing awesome things. And he is
hallelujah.
Worthy of all the praise,
hallelujah.
All the glory, all the honor.
Hallelujah.
It is due unto him. So let's praise God this morning. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. We want to say thank you this morning. We want to say thank you. We want to welcome you. Thank you for stopping by a place called New Hope. Those of you that are worshiping virtually with us, we want to say thank you. We hope you feel the spirit that like we feel it in the house this morning. We want to give God all his praise. Amen. Amen. Thank
Amen.
You, Lord.
Amen.
We're getting ready to go back to school. I know most of the state is going back, but on tomorrow, Dade County is going back to school. So we want to make sure we give extra praise and worship today for our school workers, our cafeteria, our administrators, our teachers, custodians, the students. We want to pray that we have a safe school year, a successful school year. So we want to give God extra praise this morning and a special covering for all of the people that are going back to school tomorrow. Amen.
Amen.
I'm excited this morning because my big sister is coming to deliver the word. She is not my sister by blood, but she is my sister by love and spirit. She supports me. She prays for me. She prays with me. We encourage each other. And when I'm down, she lifts me up. When she's down, I lift her up. She always has a good word to give you that God said. She has the best spirit, the most gentle spirit, and she is a woman of God. I love her beyond words. I am excited to hear what God is getting ready to say through her, and I am ready to hear what my friend, my sister, Pastor Sharia Isom Bostic is getting ready to deliver
right,
this morning.
All right,
amen.
All right, amen.
She is a woman of God. We're in for a treat this morning.
Amen.
After
amen.
Our song of preparation, we're going to hear from our sister Sharia, Pastor Reverend Sharia Isom Bostic. Amen.
Amen.
Rest. We dispatch your angels, God, to begin to minister to the hearts of your people. Oh, Lord God, we love you and we thank you because in everything we do, in everything that we go through, in everything that we face, God, we can count on you. So, God, we thank you for ministering to us this morning. We thank you, Lord God, for giving us hope this morning. We thank you for encouraging our spirits. This morning, God, we thank you for giving us breakthrough. This morning, oh God, In your son Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. And amen. God, we serve y'all. We serve an awesome God. And he is so mighty. There's nothing that we deal with that he cannot handle. I'm so honored to have this opportunity just to share this morning. And I don't take it lightly. I count it a privilege, but I also carry the weight of the responsibility of delivering God's word. And I never want to stand in this place and not bring you what he's given me. And I thank God so much that he's given me leaders, pastors, bishops, and prophets that trust what God has placed in me to allow me this opportunity to stand before you, the people they're responsible for, to declare a word. I thank God for all of you in this house. And I don't want you to put your seatbelts on, but I want your ears to be open to what God wants to say to us today. Our scripture for today is coming from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, starting at verse 7 through verse 10. Again, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, starting at verse 7 through verse 10. When you have it, say amen. If you need a couple more minutes, say hold up. All right, I didn't hear any hold up, so we ready. From the NET version, the scripture says, but we have this treasure in clay jars so that the extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are experiencing trouble on every side, but are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are persecuted, but not abandoned. We are knocked down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies. Our text or our sermon title, I was trying to come up with something, but this is our title for today, and we've all been there, but sometimes we're just down, but we're not out. Amen? I may be down, but I want you to know I'm not out. I may be experiencing hard times or trouble, but don't count me out just yet. What I look like right now does not really truly reveal who I am. I may be down at this moment, but keep on watching because I'm not out. Paul in this text is reminding us that life doesn't always bring pleasure. Every day will not be a good day. We won't always feel happy. We won't always feel wanted or connected. We might not feel supported, not even successful, and sometimes we don't even feel victorious. We're gonna have some bad days. We gotta make that clear. Bad days, times of suffering, sorrow, pain will come. Now, I know this goes against what a lot of people believe about being a child of God, a saint, even a pastor, a minister, a Christian. Some of us have been duped by the enemy and by those who taught us wrongly, but they were just doing the best they can, that when we give our life to Christ, everything becomes easy. Every day is sunny. You're happy all the time. But let me make it plain to you today. During this journey of life, we will experience some pain. We will be broken. Christian or not, suffering will come our way. Now, we love to quote scriptures, right? And when we find scriptures that we like to rehearse, we find scriptures like this. No weapon formed against me shall prosper, and every tongue that rise up against me shall be condemned. All things work together for good to them who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. We love those scriptures that tell us, if God be for me, who can be against me? We love those scriptures that say, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Yes, when we hear these verses, we go to shouting and jumping, giving God praise. And while I'm not discounting these scriptures, because every one of them speaks truth, we need to understand that we can't be so blinded by the victory that we forget, in order to obtain victory, you got to enter into a battle. Think about our military and all the wars that we've been in, Vietnam, World War I, World War II, Desert Storm, and all these other wars. While we may have obtained victory in all of these battles, some people got hurt along the way. These injuries that they have incurred or encountered may be readily visible, and sometimes they're invisible. We move through our day-to-day activities encountering all types of people who are injured and broken. Some we can see, but I would venture to say that there are a countless number of people who are hurting, who are broken, who need help, but can't find it. Hoping and wishing that someone would be able to see the pain, the frustration that's on the inside. Somebody who can look beyond the facade and the mask that they're wearing to see what's really happening on the inside. They're crying for help. Many of us right here in this church are broken. Many of you watching via streaming, broken and hurting, wanting freedom, wanting deliverance from the pain, wanting relief and a release. We're crying inwardly and we're crying outwardly. God, help me. As stated before, we all experience hurt. We've all been broken. And we can see that brokenness and that hurt because sometimes it manifests itself in the attitudes that we have, the behaviors that we manifest, the ideals and beliefs that we hold on to so tightly are a result of the hurt that we have experienced. That's why you hear that saying, hurt people hurt people. Sometimes we think we've overcome something that someone has done to us. I'm over that. I'm past that. That's what we believe until we walk into their presence and everything they've done to us comes back up. We're broken. When we find ourselves angry or thinking everything someone says is a personal indictment, they're not even thinking about us, we're broken. When we change who we are and who we're meant to be, trying to fit in with the group because we want to be accepted, we're broken. When we're afraid to show that we're vulnerable and that we're in need of help, so we wear a mask and we hide because we're broken. If I struggle with trusting others because somebody I really held dear betrayed me, we're broken. Now, being broken can come in different ways. And Bathsheba was destined to die. He said, I'm not going to kill you, but this child that you love, he ain't going to make it. David was so upset about what the prophet told him that He prayed and he fasted. He laid before God, crying out to God, wanting God to deliver his son, wanting his son to be healed, so much so that he wouldn't eat, he wouldn't do anything. And his servants were so concerned about him. And then the child dies. They were so afraid of what David was going to do because he was so hurt already. They didn't even want to tell him. But when David realized that the child was gone, he got up. And we're going to talk about that in a few minutes. But sometimes, like David, we're broken because we disobey God. We choose sin over righteousness. We choose to do it our way instead of God's way. We say, oh, God will forgive me. He sure will, but consequences still come. We're broken sometimes, not because the devil after me, not because nobody don't like me. I'm broken because I made decisions that I had to come back and face and deal with. Another way that we find ourselves broken is when others break us. And you can just write this scripture down and go back and read it. And I'm going to talk about two people, Joseph and Samson. Joseph, you're going to find this story in Genesis chapter 37, verses 1 through 36. And then Samson in Judges chapter 16. I'm going to tell you again because I do want you to go back and read it, right? You don't have to just receive the word from me, but go back and allow God to speak to you through this word. Genesis chapter 37, 1 to 36, and Samson, Judges 16. We know the story of Joseph. Joseph was one of many brothers, and he was favored by his dad, and his dad made him this coat of many colors, and his brothers didn't like it. They were jealous. Not only because he made the coat, but Joseph had some dreams. You know, when Joseph was flaunting around, talking about his pretty coat and flaunting all the dreams that he had about how his brothers were going to serve him and, you know, how he was going to be in large and in charge. And his brothers didn't like it. So when the opportunity came, they decided we're going to shut him and his dreams up. So one day when they were out, they decided they were going to kill Joseph. But instead, one of the brothers spoke up, let's not kill him. They put him in the pit to kill him, but they decided they're going to sell him into slavery. Joseph's brothers betrayed him. And because of that, he became a slave. And he became a prisoner. It seemed like one thing after the other things just got worse. So sometimes we're broken, not just because of what we've done, but what others do to us. And then we know the story of Samson, how Samson was selected by God, and he had a command from God as a Nazarite that he was not to allow scissors to touch his hair. And Samson, because of this woman that he was with, he allowed her, right, to get into that secret space and allow him to tell his secrets. And I'm not saying you can't have somebody in your life that you love, that you're vulnerable with, and that you share with. But what I'm saying is that sometimes we got to make sure that we're talking to God about those we connect with. So when we share these secrets, it's not about you destroying me, but it's about you helping me. That's just a side note too. But Samson shared his secret with Delilah, who had made an agreement with the enemy. And so they cut the hair of Samson. And when Samson stood up and shook, expecting God to move on his behalf, God didn't move. She set him up. And as a result, he was imprisoned. He was taken down. What made him strong was stripped from him. And then we're broken by God. We're going to talk about Paul and another man I'm sure you guys know very well. Paul in Acts chapter 9, raised up in the church, knew the scriptures back and forth, sat in the in the council of the Pharisees or the teachers, and he knew God's word, and because of what he knew, he began to come against the church of God, of Jesus. And in his pursuit of killing Christians, arresting them, God showed up. And he stripped Paul. He broke him down. He couldn't see. He couldn't move. He had to depend on others. And God began to speak to him. He was broken in that moment. Because here he was, the all-powerful. At that time, folk were scared when they heard the name Paul or that he was coming in their area. But when God showed up and struck him, he was broken. That power was gone. We have another one that was broken. His name was Jesus. And we could talk about a whole lot of people. Oh, he's Jesus, he God, he the Son of God. But the Bible says that he became like man. And he was broken. Not just at the Garden of Gethsemane that you see back here when he was crying out to God. But when he was on that cross, I know he was broken because he cried out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, if that's how you say it. But my God, why have you forsaken me? And there are many times that we feel like God isn't near. God doesn't hear our cry. God is not moving. We feel like God has just left us alone. But we're no different from Jesus. If he broke him, he'll break us. You may be asking yourselves, and sometimes people ask us, if God loves us so much, then why does he allow us to experience so much pain? Why would he allow us to grieve? Why would he allow us to go through these things? Now, when I was growing up, you know, we didn't have 300, 400, 500, 600 channels on the TV. So you were limited, right? And what was available to you and what you can watch. And I watched a lot of movies, and then cowboys and Indians, you know, was the big thing. And you would see these cowboys in a lot of scenes inside either like a little ring or somewhere out in the open, and they find this horse. And children may ask, why don't they break in this horse? Because when they get the horse is wild. He's operating according to his nature. He doesn't want to be ridden. He doesn't want to be kept in a pen, so to speak, or to have boundaries. He wants to be able to roam and move as he pleases and do what he wants to do. But why does the cowboy go through all of this trying to get on the horse? The horse throw him off. He's hitting the ground. And they keep at it, and they keep at it until finally the horse relents and submits. That's what God does to us. Because our nature, our flesh, doesn't want to submit to God. We want to do what we want to do, when we want to do it, how we want to do it, where and with whom we want to do it with. We don't want boundaries. I'm a grown man. Who are you to tell me? I'm a grown woman. I pay my own bills. I make my own decisions. And that's why we're broken. But God has to break our will. He has to break us down so that he can get to what he has placed in us. Let's go back to our original scripture and look at verse 7, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. This is why God allows us to go through. This is why he allows us to be broken. The scripture says, but we have this, what we got? Treasure. He's placed something inside of you that's valuable, that's precious, that he wants to use. The cowboy can't use the horse wild. He can't ride him to get to his next destination. He can't use the horse to pull a buggy or a carriage. He has to break them. And so it's the same with us. God has to break us to get to that thing inside of us that he's placed in us that is of value to him and to the kingdom. He values us, but we can't do it in our own power. That's why you got to break, so that you and I and everyone understands that what they see coming out of us had nothing to do with us. It's the extraordinary power of God that's being revealed in us. Who is that earthen vessel or that clay jar? We are. God has placed something extremely valuable in all of us, and in order to get it, we got to be broken. We got to be broken. We run from it. We try to protect our feelings. Excuse me. We try to protect ourselves. We try to protect our children because we don't want them to experience hurt and brokenness. And sometimes in doing that, we stifle them. And the same with us. If we don't allow God to do the breaking, or if we allow ourselves to be stuck in those other situations in which we're broken, then we're stifling what God has placed inside of us. Why don't we see the manifestation of God's power? Because we hide. We're resisting the breaking. We want to do it our way. And so we're stifling what God wants to do. We want what he promised. The problem is we want it our way. In the book of, and just write it down, 2 Kings chapter 5, there was a man named Naaman. And he was a Syrian warrior. And he was strong. He was powerful. His king loved him because when he went out to war, he conquered and brought back wealth to Syria. But one day, Naaman ran up on something he couldn't handle. It was called leprosy. And so when Naaman experienced this sickness that is debilitating and could even lead to death, he had a servant girl who was an Israelite who told his wife, if you get Naaman before the prophet of God, he can be healed. So Naaman went to the king and told the king what the young lady had said, and the king wrote him a letter and said, take this letter to the king of Israel to get healed. Not only did he take the letter, but he took a whole lot of money with him too. He went to the king of Israel thinking that his favor with his king and his money could buy him deliverance. He took the money and ran to the king, and the king said, who am I? I'm not God. You can't buy this thing. Your king has no power or authority here. This is not how you're going to get delivered. But the prophet of God, Elisha, heard what had happened. He said, send Naaman over here. Let me talk to him. So Naaman went, and when he got close, Elijah sent his servant out to Naaman and said, go wash in the Jordan 7 times and you'll be healed. Healing is what he wanted, right? That's what he asked for. God, I want to be free. God, I want to be delivered of this thing. Help me, God. And God gives us instructions. And what do we do with it? Naaman, when he got instructions on how to be healed, Naaman got an attitude. Can you believe that? You just asked me for healing, and now when I tell you how to get it, you got an attitude because you don't like what I told you to do. You want to go forward in God. You want victory and success. And I tell you, you got to live holy. Don't get mad because I said live holy. That's how you're going to get it. You want to lose weight? The doctor says, stop eating this, this, and this. What? I can't have that. But I want to be delivered. We want what he has, but we want it on our own terms. Naaman got an attitude, and he said, first of all, I can't believe this man didn't even come out here and talk to me. Don't he know who I am? I am Naaman, one of the most powerful warriors in Syria, and I come to him, and he sent me his servant. I'm sick and in the hospital. How dare Bishop send somebody else to come see me and pray for me? Why he couldn't come himself? He couldn't believe it. He didn't even come talk to me. He could have come out and just waved his hand and called on his God, and I could have been healed. That could have happened. That's what Naaman wanted him to do. But God said, that's not what I'm asking you to do. So then he's trying to tell God how to deliver him. Just wave your hand and God will do it. Naaman was upset. Go to the Jordan. The Jordan is dirty. It's muddy. I'm not getting in there. But that was the instruction. Why didn't God send me to all these other rivers that are out here? They're pretty. They're clean. Why the Jordan? So Naaman could have missed his opportunity because he didn't like the package in which God delivered or gave his plan for deliverance. Stop looking at the package. It ain't about me. It ain't about Bishop. It ain't about Lonzo. It's about what God says. And when he sends you a word, instead of rejecting what God says, we gotta obey. We're broken because of disobedience. We miss opportunities because we want it done our way. When God says, I've already laid it out for you. And in all of Naaman's complaining, guess what? God didn't change it. This is what I told you to do. And if you want it, you're going to do it my way. So Naaman could have missed his opportunity. But the people around him said, what you got to lose? You're going to die if you don't. And we are dying. Because we want to do it our way. We are ineffective in our work, in our ministry, because we want to do it our way. We can't stand when problems and pressures come because we want to do it our way. And God says, until you do it my way, you're going to remain in that same state. So the people of God, people around Naaman said, man, what's your problem? Let's go get this. And so he went to the Jordan and did as the man of God told him. And he was healed. All we got to do is do what God told us. And he'll heal us. If we go back to these situations, I did want to encourage you. I know we done whipped you a little bit. But I want you to understand that we're broken because God is trying to get something out of us. And others may have done the breaking. We may have done it ourselves. Or we might be in the hand of God experiencing a breaking. But one thing about it is once you're broken and you allow God to begin to move, he pulls out what he's placed inside of you. And that thing in you is so great. It's so valuable, it's so precious that, you know, you have to, you got to let go of everything you thought everything you wanted, every idea, belief, and concept you hold that's contrary to what he says, you got to be willing to let it go. So when Naaman let go, he got healed. David, after his son died, repented and cried out to God because he knew he was wrong. God, I messed up. You're right. I know I shouldn't have taken that man's wife. I know I shouldn't have had him killed. I was wrong for that. And he began to worship God. And God blessed him and gave him another son. His name was Solomon. And Solomon was able to do what David wanted to do and build God a house of worship. Even when we're broken, even when we're going through, when it looks like it's at the end, like with David's son, God always got something coming behind it. But we've got to get through the struggle to get to the victory. Joseph went from being a slave to being a prisoner to becoming a prince or in charge, a governor. And because he was able to go through and continue to trust God, although others wronged him, God elevated him, and he was able to be a blessing to the kingdom of Egypt and to his own family, even those who betrayed him. See, when you're broken, and Joseph was, because when his brother showed up, he went all, you know, we good at first. He gave them some challenges, but then he forgave, and they were able to reconnect. Don't allow circumstances that happened to you in the past keep you from relationships or from connections that you need to make to move you forward. Samson prayed, his hair grew back, and God was able gave him enough strength to destroy his enemies. Paul, instead of persecuting the church, became the mouthpiece of God, establishing and building churches all over the then known world, and wrote most of the New Testament. All I'm saying is God allows the breaking because he's trying to make us. Stop resisting it. Allow him to move you through it. They had been broken so that the treasure could be revealed to them first and then to the world. I know you're broken. I know you're hurting. We've lost so much in these 2 years. So many people, so many things. Sometimes we want to throw in the towel. But I just want to remind you that this is only temporary. Just as God came through for Joseph, David, Naaman, Samson, Jesus, he's coming through for you. It looks bad. It feels bad. But I promise you, once you release it to him, he can and he will deliver you. If you gotta cry, cry. If you need to scream, scream. God sees what you're going through. And he wants you to release it to him. He said in his word, cast all your cares upon me because I care for you. Others may not value you, but he does. Others may not see you, but God does. He sees and he cares, but he can't move. Until we give it to him. Until you stop fighting the breaking process and let him reveal his treasure, you'll remain in that state. It's in those lowest moments that we get to experience God even more. He says, when you are weak, then am I strong. It's okay to be weak. I know the culture of the day says man up, toughen up, don't be a wuss, a chump, or whatever they call it all, whatever they're saying now. Because we want to put up this facade that we're strong. But we're weak. That's why when people approach you and they don't necessarily agree with what you're saying, you think it's an indictment against you. I can love you and disagree with you. I'm not against you because I don't agree with what you're saying at the moment. But it's that brokenness because we're insecure. We want people on our side that we get upset. That's why we stay bound, because we prefer hiding over deliverance. I don't want them to see me like that. I don't want y'all to know what I've been going through. I can't let you see my pain. I'm too embarrassed to share this situation. What are they going to think of me if they found out? And so we hide and we stay bound instead of experiencing deliverance. God will illuminate our situation and he will bring life. Come out of hiding. Come out of hiding. I know we're in a pandemic and we have mandates to wear a mask, but I want you to take off the mask. Not this one, but the one you hide behind. The one where you hide your true self behind, because you don't want us to see you. You don't want others to see you. There's an artist. His name is Todd Galbraith. And he shares a testimony of a time when he was at one of the lowest points in his life. He felt like the weight of the world was on his shoulders. Every time he thought things were getting better, something else would happen. He goes on to say that he sat in his kitchen and asked God, "What is going on?" And I know you guys have never been there, but I've asked God many times, "What's going on? Why this? Why now? God, I don't know if I can handle this. I don't know if I can make it through this. God, I can't feel you. I can't seem to touch you because I'm broken." But like Todd, I've asked God that many times. And Todd says that as he asked God those questions, the words of this song came to him. And what touches me most are the words of his testimony, because he said he stood there washing the dishes with tears rolling from his face. Tears are a manifestation of pain, of brokenness. In his pain, God wanted Todd to remember. What? What did he want him to remember? He wanted Todd to remember how he'd moved for him in the past. I want to encourage you to worship God through your pain. I want to encourage you to allow God entry into that space you keep hiding from him and others, so that you can experience the deliverance that he wants to give you, so that that treasure he's placed inside of you can come forth. We might be That's what he told the Lord in his pain.
Lord, you are good. You meant so good.
Even when it's hurting, you can declare that he's good.
I can praise you enough.
Because I owe you. Yes, you have, God.
So good.
He's been good.
You've been so good to me.
So earlier this year, I went through a challenge of my own. And I'm not sure now that I think about it and I was going through this message, if I kept it within walls to just deal with it and be protected, or if I was really hiding. Because sometimes when you're viewed as a strong person, it's hard to be vulnerable. It's hard to show folk when you're struggling and when you're hurting. So in February, I went to the doctor. And we go every year, you know, we get all our checkups, ladies. We got 100 of them. And so I went to the doctor, and, you know, it's routine. We do it every year, and we get results. So the doctor's office called, and I'm expecting, oh, you know, the normal. Everything is good. All is well. But that's not the report I got. They said our findings are inconclusive. And we need you to make another appointment. We need you to come in for another test and bring all your medical history with you. So when I went through that at the first, I'm like, okay, that's fine. You know, we're good. They're going to see or whatever. I go back for the second test, wait for the results. And they call back and they say, we still don't like what we see. We need you to come in again. We need you to go back. We need an ultrasound. So I go and I take an ultrasound. You know, and I start to get a little anxious. But every time that anxiety came up, I remember what my pastor always teach me, have a God said for your situation. So when the enemy would try to bring doubt, when he would try to make me really afraid and change my actions, I would speak what God said. But I'm just being open, because I'm not saying I was completely at peace, but I was trying to walk in faith and believe God. So when I got the results of the ultrasound, they called me back and they said, well, we're still inconclusive on the left side, but we found a mass in your right breast. So when they told me that, that kind of took me back for a minute. Because there are so many things that we go through and we overcome. But you know, some things we make them so monumental and so hard, and we forget about who our God is. Amen. And I talked to my mom, I talked to my husband, they knew. I didn't even tell my sisters. I didn't tell my bishop. I didn't tell anybody. And I probably was hiding, I gotta be honest. But I continued to pray, and I continued to pray. The enemy had me saying, girl, check out your insurance stuff, make some adjustments, do this, do that. And every time he would come, I would say, but my God says, I can overcome this. Greater is he that's in me. My God is a healer. Healing is the children's bread. By his stripes, I am healed. Amen. And I began to say, God, even if they find it there, Jesus, you can still take care of it.
Yes, God.
So they told me to schedule an appointment for an MRI, an appointment with a surgeon. And so I went and I took the MRI, waiting for the report to come back. And in all of this, I continued to go to work every day. I continued to come and sing. So sometimes when y'all see me up there and I'm praising God, and I'm sure the same is with you, you don't always know what's going on the inside of a person.
Amen.
But I was praying and worrying and trusting God. And God, I know who you are.
Hallelujah.
And I know I haven't finished what you've called me to do.
Hallelujah.
So I'm trusting you to move in this situation.
Yes, Jesus.
And so I went and took the MRI. And I went to see the surgeon. And the surgeon did another ultrasound and showed me the mass. But what I thank God about is that when he finished, he said, but it's benign.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. It's benign. You don't have to worry. There's no cancer.
Yes.
You're going to come through this. And
Hallelujah.
I just had to give God praise because
Hallelujah.
We stand in church every Sunday.
Yes, God.
And we honor God. We worship God. We love on people, but so many times we're hurting. We're broken on the inside. And we're afraid to let people know. And because we won't share, we remain bound. Because we won't share, we can't get delivered. Because the enemy wants us to think that if we open our mouths, shame will come. Embarrassment will come, but I want you to know when you open your mouth, deliverance is at your door. So I go back in 6 months, and they're gonna keep watching. They want to see, you know, if it grows. But I'm declaring in this house today that it will not. It will shrink. It will dissipate. It will be gone. Because my God is a healer. He's a deliverer. And he will move on behalf of his children. He's been so good. This is like one of my favorite songs. Because no matter how much I've hurt, I've gone through so much in life, and I'm sure you guys have too. But even in all that I've been through, I can declare that my God is good.
Yes, he is.
So I go on birth window on to say, he said, so many doors you've opened. So many ways you made. So many times you've healed me. You've been better than good.
Yes, God.
And that's what I believe. That's what I stand on. Because he did it for me over and over again.
Yes, Lord.
This is not my first bout with a tumor.
Yes, yes.
But my God is faithful.
Yes, he is. Hallelujah.
So I just declare, come on.
So many doors, so many ways you made, so many times you've healed me, you've been better than good to me, so many doors you've opened, so many ways you made, so many times you've healed me, you've been better than good to me.
Been so good, Lord. You are good. You've been better than good. I can praise you enough. I owe you my life. Can't praise you enough. Even if I tried, 'cause you've been
Come on and give God praise. Amen. Wow. What a word this morning. Yes. This was her hour. Amen. And may the Lord God himself touch from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet and every place in between. May he renew and restore and make whole in Jesus' name. Come on, put your hands together. Give God praise. My God. I know you were blessed today. I was blessed tremendously. Amen. What a word. She never fails. God never fails. Whenever she comes, she always have a rhema for the house. We thank God for Pastor Sharia Isom Bostic. Yes, sir. What a word, Sharia. As you were talking in your concluding statements, I heard the Lord says, amen, as you were concluding, he says, sometimes God break us not to make us bitter, but he break us to make us better. Amen. So in our brokenness, even while we're going through, know that you're not going to be made bitter, but in the end, you're going to be made better. And then I heard the Lord say this, Saria, we are just like the vessel in the hands of a potter. While in his hand, the vessel he was making became broken, became marred, damaged. But what did he do? He put it back on the wheel. And he made another vessel that was pleasing to the potter. So he can repair. And he can make whole. And he will make us better and never bitter. Amen. The doors of the church stands ajar. We offer Christ to you, my brother, my sister. What a word you've heard today. You may be broken because of something you've done, something what others done, or what God has allowed. Either way, it's to bring you home to Christ. Come on, Lonzo. This what he wants to do.
He will give you better life.
Life more abundantly.
Life abundantly.
Oh, 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 oh. Come on, come on, come on.
Come on.
Yes, sir.
To Christ.
He can make you whole again. All you gotta do is come. All you gotta do is come. Oh,
oh, my brother,
we offer Christ to you.
Thank you, God, for making me better. Never making me bitter. Come on to Christ.
To Christ.
You may have your seats. We have done as the Lord has required, and yet there is room. If Israel be lost, Jacob will not lose his reward. Prophets, what a word we had today. Sharia laid it out today. It was potent, it was powerful, and it was precious. Amen. It bless you.
I just want to say, Sharia, thank you for that potent, that powerful. I mean, it was packed with so much information. I thank God for that. You said we're down. You can be down, but not out. And all of us have been down some, but don't count me out because I'm down. Hallelujah, because if you're in the Lord, you're going to get back up. Amen. You can get back up and you can brush yourself off and go again. God will give you the power. That was an awesome word. You know what, Doug? What I like that when she talked about brokenness, she said, God break us. Sometimes he break us, but God don't, he ain't going to break you. In order to break you, he going to make you better. Nobody likes to be broken. God uses brokenness. Whoever falls on a stone, sometimes you can break your leg or you can break your arm. But you know what? You can heal when you're in the Lord. And I don't, whatever the doctors say, we're standing on what God say. We can have everything God say. And I like where it says, James says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. God is working it out. He's always working it out. Because if you have faith in him, you trust him. And I like what Paul says. He said, Paul at first, he begged the Lord to remove this thorn in our flesh. Sometimes we have some things and it just stick there. It seems like it ain't moved. And he begged the Lord. But nevertheless, sometimes it produces patience in us. We got to wait sometime. We wanted it quick and in a hurry. You know how y'all like stuff quick in a hurry. Everything's going to come in a hurry. You just got to be patient. So I just thank God, because in during this pandemic, everybody, I don't know about y'all, but I done been broke. I mean, down, and not broke like with money, but broken in your spirit. You lost some loved ones along the way and who was dear to your heart. But you got to trust God and have faith in him and don't throw in the towel. And I just thank God. I might be down, but I'm never out, because God is never out. He's always got blessings more than enough in store for all of us, enough for me and you, if you stay connected. And that's the difference. When you're broken, you got to stay connected, because if you're disconnected, my God, you out of gas. So just stay connected, my daughter. I just want to say to you, we pray that God's strength in you. We pray that God's power just keep you. The best is yet to come. I don't know what the doctor saw, but I know what God say. By your stripes, his scribes, you are healed. He said he's the God that healeth thee. And God, we stand on his word. We decree his word. We trust this word. We believe in this word. So we just speak right now that God, just right now in the name of Jesus, go in and just turn that thing around for your good. The best is yet to come. And we look into the hills to which come of our help. Our help come from him. So it's already done in Jesus' name. We just give him praise. Y'all can come on and give God some praise right now, because the battle is not hers. The battle is not ours, but it is the Lord. Hallelujah. I know what they say. They say that's what the doctor said. But what does God's word say? I believe what the word say. I stand on the word. I decree the word. I declare the word. And I trust the word. And I abide in the word, so I can have what it says. Amen, amen. To God be the glory. God bless you. What a mighty word, a good word, a powerful word for such a time as this.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. Amen. This is the day the Lord made. I tell you, this is a great day in the Lord, and we thank him so much for the rhema we received today. It's a good time now, amen, to seal the deal. What I call sealing the deal is planning our tithes and our offerings and giving to God what is rightfully due to him. Amen. It's time to give. And we want to thank you in advance for sharing and being such good stewards over God's good treasure that he's placed in your possession. This is our time to sow. And we have various platforms where you can participate. Number one, we have a Cash App, NHMBC 1881. NHMBC 1881. It's on your screen. You can plant your seeds there, your tithes, your offerings, and gifts. Or you can go to online to Tithely, or you can give by text giving. All the information is right before you. And you can also go to our website, newhopembc.com, newhopembc.com, and press the give or the donate button and give your tithes and offerings right there. And last but not least, you can always write the check, put it in an envelope, amen, bring it by the church, or give it while you're here, amen. We're here every day from 9 to 5, Monday through Friday, just to service and to serve you. Thank you in advance for being such good stewards over the seed, over the treasures God have given you. This is our way to partake and to participate in the planned process promulgated by God, amen, to get a blessing back to our house. Amen. Thank you so much for being such great support over the years, and definitely during this pandemic, to help make ministry magic right here at The Hope. God bless you, and God keep you is our prayer. Amen. Thank you so much. Listen, let me say also thank you to the New Hope family, to the New Mount Zion family, to all of our friends and faithful supporters. Thank you for your prayers and support on yesterday. As you know, we laid to rest our father in the ministry, the Reverend Edward Grace. Continue to pray for the Grace family and the New Mount Zion family. What a great loss. A great general has gone home. I heard Bishop Ray say yesterday, he says, on this side, we celebrate a homegoing, but on the other side, they celebrate a homecoming. Yesterday, also in Orlando, a good friend of our family, the prophetess pastor, Sheila J. Spencer, was laid to rest in Orlando and the Times of Refreshing family. Please pray for the Spencer family and the Times of Refreshing families. And again, we need your prayers right here at home. Amen. My good friend and brother, Pastor Billy Strange of the new Mount Calvary Baptist Church, lost his mother. And on next Sunday, they're going to be laying her to rest as well. My good friend, Tracy McLeod, of the pastor of the Peace Missionary Baptist Church, lost his mother, and they're going to be laying her to rest this coming week as well. So pray much for the various families that we know, not only here at New Hope, but those external to New Hope. We have so much to pray about and to pray for. We know that some loss are great whenever they're near and dear, whether it's your spouse or your child or a friend or a loved one. We know there's a great void, but only God and time can fill that void. And we are praying for you as well. Amen. Continue to be faithful to the kingdom in the midst of this pandemic that we are now in. We are not going to panic. We're going to continue to praise God. Amen. And we're not going to be fearful. We're going to walk in faith. And even though we are broken in the process, we do know that God is going to make us better and never bitter. Thank you again, Pastor Sharia, for that wonderful word today. Amen. All right. Listen, our Dade County schools are returning back to the classroom. We're praying much for our students, our support staff, our teachers, amen, our educators, and all the support. Let's pray much for them, amen, as they reengage and open up our schools. This invisible enemy has not yet relented, and we must do all we can to protect ourselves and our families. If you have not been vaccinated, please, please, there are so many outlets ready and prepared right now so you can get vaccinated. Amen. That's your only defense right now against this invisible enemy. Please protect yourself, protect your families. Wear your mask. Stay socially distanced. Wash your hands. Do all that we can do to make sure that our families and our children and our spaces are safe. This is what we need to do. Go by the science. Don't listen to them other politicians. You do what you got to do. Amen. 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 It's our babies now. Come on, it's our babies now. And I said this the other day, and I'm going to say it again. I'm liking this season that we're in. It's like when you go to the 4th of July celebration, and you see all the fireworks. Every now and then at the beginning, you hear a pop here and a pop there and a pop here. But at the finale, the grand finale, there's popping everywhere. And I believe this pandemic now is just this at the last end of it, and it is showing up by ways that we didn't even imagine. But we got to stay the course, amen, and do what needs to be done to keep ourselves safe. It's going to be over after a while, but until then, let us remain prayerful and let us remain vigilant. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. Thanks to all of our members who are here today. Amen. All of our friends who are watching over Facebook Live, thank you for hanging in there. We've experienced some problems, but we're going to work through it. But God has spoken. Let the church say amen.
everybody.
Say amen.
God has spoken.
God has spoken.
So let the church.
Let the church.
Let the whole church.
Amen.
Oh, can I get a witness?
Let the church.
Oh.
Say amen.
To what his will is.
Let the church.
To what his word saying.
Amen.
God has spoken.
God has spoken.
So let the church.
Let the church.
Let the whole church.
Amen.
Oh. Make this your response.
Amen.
Whatever he says.
Amen.
From the healing of your body.
Amen.
To the raising of the dead.
Amen.
No matter how you feel it.
Amen.
How your world is feeling.
Amen.
Battle on through the night.
Amen.
Cause we going to fight.
Amen.
Even in the valley.
Amen.
Standing at your red sea.
Amen.
Continue to say.
Amen.
Cause your help. It's on the way.
Amen. God has spoken.
Well, well, well.
Let the church.
Let the church say.
Say amen.
Just got a note this morning. Let us pray for my good friend and brother, Reverend Jeffrey Mack, pastor of Second Canaan. He's in the hospital fighting, amen, for his health. And we know that God is able, amen, to seal him and to protect him and return him back to his active duty. Amen. There's so much to pray for. We are praying for Tony, Mother Strange. We are praying for Tony that God gets give him strength and heal his body and bring it back home. We thank God for all of you who are here. Let us continue to hold on to God's unchanging hand because we know that in the end, we all gonna win. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, and one day present us right before his Father. To him be love, dominion, and power now and forever. Let the church say, amen. Amen. All right, we love you. Oh!
God has spoken.
Well, well, well.
Let the church.
Let the whole church.
Amen.
Let the whole church. Let the whole church. Oh! Let the church say
amen,
amen, amen. God bless you. Thank you so much. God bless you. Love you. For those who have prepared your offerings and you have not had a chance to give it, there are representatives at the door.